Обратно задача для уравнения высших порядков. Ну, по-видимому, пока к нам не присоединились иностранные гости, можно, наверное, говорить по-русски.
Да,
Спасибо.
спасибо в первую очередь организаторам за возможность сделать доклад на этой конференции. Нормально видно мою презентацию?
Да, Наташа, все в
Да,
порядке.
все видно.
Да, значит, мой доклад посвящен обратной спектральной задаче для дифференциальных операторов высших порядков. Высшими порядками обычно называются порядки выше второго. Рассмотрим сначала классическую постановку обратной задачи для второго порядка. Собственно, вот 1, 2 – это задача Штурма Лювиля с потенциалом Q вещественным из L1 и с условиями Дирихле. И, собственно, вот здесь на слайде приведена постановка обратной задачи. Единственность решения этой задачи была доказана в работе Марченко, впоследствии в работе Гельфанда и Левитана был разработан конструктивный метод ее решения и получены необходимые достаточно условия разрешимости. Собственно, в чем состоит задача? Пусть у нас лямбда n – это собственное значение задачи Штурма Лювиля, yn – соответствующие собственные функции, нормированные вот таким условием. Тогда весовые числа вводятся таким вот образом, как квадраты норм собственных функций, и задача стоит в восстановлении по спектральным данным, собственным значениям и весовым числам потенциала Q. В данном докладе мы будем рассматривать обобщение этой задачи на операторы высших порядков. Значит, рассмотрим уравнение, такое вот уравнение порядка n больше 2. Пусть LK это при каждом k от 1 до n-1, это кривая задача для уравнения 3 со следующими кривыми условиями. Для k-й задачи у нас накладывается k условий в левом конце интервала и n-k в правом конце. Собственно, можно, здесь вот приведены простейшие кривые условия, можно рассматривать кривые условия более общего характера, распадающиеся. Но я здесь решила для простоты ограничиться вот этим случаем, который аналогичен условиям Дирихле. Почему он наиболее удобен? Потому что в нем не возникает вопрос о восстановлении каких-либо коэффициентов кривых условий. То есть если у нас будут какие-то кривые условия других порядков, то там будут еще какие-то коэффициенты, и нужно будет еще их восстанавливать. Здесь мы будем вести речь только о восстановлении коэффициентов дифференциального выражения по следующим данным. Обозначим через лямбда LK собственное значение соответствующей задачи LK. Можно показать, что, как и в случае второго порядка, их будет счетное множество, они нумеруются. Вот, для фиксированной задачи собственное значение нумеруется индексом L, который пробегает натуральные числа. И бета, ЛК, соответствующие весовые числа. Мы в дальнейшем посмотрим, как они вводятся, но они в некотором смысле обобщают вот те весовые числа, которые в задаче Марченко. И задача стоит в том, чтобы по собственным значениям и весовым числам этих n-1 задачи восстановить коэффициенты PS. Эта постановка была дана в работах Либензона. Вот, но впоследствии, вот в частности в работах Юрко, было показано, что такие данные однозначно определяют коэффициенты дифференциального уравнения только при выполнении условия разделенности. В чем состоит это условие? Ну вот здесь лямбда ЛК – это спектр k-й задачи. Лямбда LK плюс 1, спектр K плюс 1 задачи. Условие разделенности состоит в том, что спектры двух соседних задач с индексами K и K плюс 1 не пересекаются, то есть не содержат общих значений.
А могут и пересечься, да?
Да, вообще говоря, могут. И в работах Юрко был построен контрпример, когда действительно какие-то условия разделенности не выполняются, и, соответственно, вот эти данные Лебензона не будут однозначно определять коэффициенты дифференциального выражения. И поэтому Юрко была введена другая спектральная характеристика, которую я называю матрицей Вейли-Юрко, которая в любом случае однозначно определяет коэффициенты уравнения вне зависимости от поведения спектра, то есть даже когда условия разделенности не выполняются. Собственно, я немножко в общих чертах остановлюсь на их методе, потому что мои исследования, по сути дела, развивают этот метод. Метод называется методом спектральных отображений. И, в общем, он состоит в том, что нелинейная обратная задача сводится к некоторому линейному уравнению. В случае конечного интервала это уравнение в банаховом пространстве бесконечных ограниченных последовательностей, и оно рассматривается при каждом фиксированном x. То есть при каждом x у нас пси и пси с волной – это бесконечные ограниченные последовательности, r с волной – это некоторый линейный компактный оператор в этом пространстве, и i – тождественный оператор. При этом оператор R с волной и элемент пси с волной строятся по спектральным данным, то есть для них там есть конкретные формулы построения. А в свою очередь неизвестная последовательность пси, она связана с неизвестными коэффициентами. То есть решение этого уравнения – это некоторый ключевой шаг метода. То есть это уравнение, оно представляет собой некоторую бесконечную систему, бесконечную линейную систему. Далее, решив эту систему, получаем некоторую последовательность, и по ней уже по точным формулам строятся коэффициенты в виде некоторых рядов. Но, к сожалению, у меня нет возможности тут в коротком докладе более подробно останавливаться на этом методе. Я вот, насколько помню, в прошлом году как раз более подробно про него рассказывала. Вот. Но стоит отметить, что и у Лебензона, и у Юрко для их задач, то есть у Лебензона с условием разделенности, у Юрко в общем случае, были сформулированы некоторые теоремы о существовании решения обратной задачи, но все эти теоремы обладали определенными недостатками, как я считаю, довольно существенными. Во-первых, в них и у Лебензона, и у Юрко требовалась разрешимость основного уравнения. А это, вообще говоря, довольно существенное требование. То есть для существования решения требовалось, чтобы это уравнение было разрешимо. Совершенно непонятно, как эту разрешимость, ну вот так вот, это нетривиальный вопрос, ее проверить до какой-то конкретной последовательности данных. И вот у них у обоих было это требование. У Юрко в его монографии приводятся доказательства разрешимости основного уравнения в самосопряженном случае для второго порядка, для уравнения Штурма-Лювиля. Но вот для высших порядков эта разрешимость, насколько мне известно, не доказывалась. Но было доказательство только в локальном случае, когда берется малое возмущение данных некоторой задачи. То есть только локально, и локально разрешимость получается за счет малости по норме оператора R с волной. Кроме того, и Лебензон, и Юрко накладывали слишком сильные ограничения на асимптотические, слишком сильные асимптотические условия на спектральные данные, которые гарантировали попадание построенных коэффициентов в соответствующий класс. А у Лебензона рассматривался вот такой класс, когда коэффициент PS S раз непрерывно дифференцируемая функция, а у Юрко, соответственно, вот такой класс. Он рассматривал задачу при разных ню, но вот самый здесь трудный случай при ню равном нулю, у нас получается, что коэффициент PS SW1S. Вот, ну, собственно, здесь справедливости ради стоит отметить, что известны и другие подходы к обратным задачам для операторов высших порядков. В частности, метод оператора преобразования здесь пытались применять, причем достаточно интенсивно изучали этот вопрос советские математики. Лев Аронович Сахнович, Хачатрян и Маламут. Ну, и также здесь приведен ряд других математиков, которые рассматривали задачи в разных других постановках. Но что касается оператора преобразования, то этот метод здесь оказался неэффективен по той причине, что оператор преобразования для уравнения высших порядков существует не всегда, а только при некоторых условиях. Ну и вот, как правило, здесь рассматривались некоторые условия аналитичности на коэффициенты. То есть, когда коэффициенты являются аналитическими функциями, либо кусочно-аналитическими. Ну и вот, в частности, Марком Михайловичем, здесь присутствовавшим, был получен такой результат относительно вообще существования оператора преобразования. Вот, ну, грубо говоря, когда половина коэффициентов дифференциального выражения аналитическая и существует оператор преобразования, то и вторая половина коэффициентов тоже аналитическая. То есть понятно, что здесь это, ну, оператор преобразования это существует при каких-то довольно существенных требованиях на коэффициенты. Вот, и поэтому я здесь развиваю подход Либинзона и Юрко, поскольку он позволяет работать с достаточно общими классами коэффициентов. И моя здесь цель изначальная была в том, чтобы перенести их результаты на случай коэффициентов распределений. То есть когда коэффициенты из некоторых классов обобщенных функций. Но помимо этого...
Наташа, Наташа, я очень извиняюсь. Виктор... К нам подключился Марк.
Да, да, да. Я обратил внимание, у нас сейчас есть иностранный участник, так что если
не перейти ли нам
если
на родной
будет
английский
удобно,
язык.
То, да.
Okay, let me continue my talk in English. It was some preliminary part, and now I'll proceed to the problem statement. So actually. In my research, which I will discuss next, I have not only generalized the results of Libinzon and Yurko to the class of distributional coefficients, but also overcame these two difficulties. So the solvability of the main equation was proved in under some conditions of self-adjointness. And also this restriction also was overcome. And so I will show which asymptotical restriction I have. So let us proceed to the problem statement. We will consider the higher order differential equation of this form, where n is greater or equal than 2. This notation means rounding a real number down. And tau nu are coefficients of such classes. So here is more detailed explanation. We assume that tau zero belongs to class W2 minus 1. This is the class of generalized functions whose antiderivatives belong to L2. Tau 1 is of class W2 zero, which is L2. And for k greater or equal than 1, we have regular coefficients of some Sobolev space belonging to the corresponding Sobolev spaces. Here is an example for n equals 4. Here we have three coefficients. Tau 0 is from W2 minus 1, tau 1 from L2, and tau 2 from W2 1. Of course, this form can be easily reduced to the form considered by Libinzon and Yurko. And the coefficients PS will be of the same spaces. But for us, it will be more convenient to consider this divergent form because we will have some self-adjointness conditions. First, I need to explain in which sense do we understand these equations with distributional coefficient. We understand them in the sense of the regularization approach of Mirzoyev and Shkalikov. This approach consists in the reducing a higher order differential equation to the first order system of this form, where y is a vector function, lambda is the constant matrix which corresponds to the influence of the spectral parameter, and f is some matrix function with elements from L1, so all its elements are regular. They are not singular distributions. They all are regular, and these elements are related to the coefficients of the differential expression. Here is using the elements of the matrix F, one can introduce the quasi derivatives by this formula. The zeros quasi derivative is just the function y, and the quasi derivative of order k is introduced by this recurrent formula. Also, we introduce the domain df. Df is the set of functions whose quasi derivatives of orders k from 0 to n minus 1 belong to absolutely continuous functions. So if we have y from df, then all the quasi derivatives from of orders from 0 to n are correctly defined as functions of L1, because you see, if you have k equals n, this quasi derivative will be absolutely continuous, so its derivative exists, and this sum also exists, so we have that yn is an integrable function. And this is a definition. A matrix function F is called associated matrix for a differential equation Ln if for any function of this domain this equality holds. It can be shown that if y belongs to this domain, then the differential expression is correctly defined in the as a distribution. So this will be some distribution, and it equals the nth quasi derivative, which is a regular function. Because of this, ln of y is also a regular function. So this is the meaning of the regularization approach. We construct such a matrix function associated with a differential expression, which allows us to understand it in the regular sense. How to construct the associated matrix? Such constructions are already known for various classes of differential expressions. For example, for the Sturm-Liouville equation with the potential of W2 minus 1, the associated matrix has this form. It was considered in the paper by Savchuk and Shkalikov, and in many other studies on Sturm-Liouville operators with distribution potentials. In our case, for the differential expression of higher orders, when tau nu belongs to W2 nu minus 1, we consider such structure of associated matrices denote by sigma 0 an antiderivative of tau 0, and then here the structure of associated matrix is presented for n equals 4 and n equals 5. The other coefficients tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, they are regular. So all the elements of associated matrices are regular functions. So by using these matrices, we introduce the quasi-derivatives, and then we can consider the boundary value problems LK for our equation with the with these boundary conditions. Theorem one describes the behavior of the spectra for these problems. Each spectrum is a countable set of eigenvalues. They can be numbered by indices L according to the asymptotics. From this asymptotics, we can see first that for sufficiently large L, these eigenvalues are simple because they split by asymptotics. And also for sufficiently large L, we have the separation condition because for large L, the eigenvalues have different signs, plus or minus, depending on whether K is odd or even. So, for example, if n is even, then we have that lambda L1 are negative, they tend to minus infinity, and lambda L2 are positive, they tend to plus infinity. So for large indices L, they are separated, but for small L, they can be not separated. Next, let us introduce some additional characteristics. Denote by phi k the solutions of the considered equation with these boundary conditions. For each k, phi k satisfies k conditions at zero and n minus k conditions at one. Phi k are called the Weyl solutions, and the matrix function which consists of the quasi derivatives is called the Weyl-Yurko matrix. It is the most important spectral characteristics in this theory. According to the boundary conditions for phi k, the Weyl-Yurko matrix has this form. It is a lower triangular matrix with the unit diagonal. And the lower diagonal elements can be represented in this form, where delta gk are some entire functions, analytic in the whole complex plane. They are characteristics determinants of some boundary value problems. In particular, delta kk is the characteristic determinant of lk. The functions mgk are meromorphic, and for the case column of this matrix, the poles of these meromorphic functions are coincide with the eigenvalues lambda lk. If the separation condition holds, then any two neighboring columns have distinct poles. For us, it will be not very convenient to consider this meromorphic matrix function. It will be more convenient to consider some constant matrices related to its singular points. For simplicity, we assume that the eigenvalues of the problem LK of each problem LK are simple. Then the Weyl-Yurko matrix has such a Lorentz series representation at each pole. Here, this notation is used for the coefficients of the Lorentz series, which are n times n matrices. And using these coefficients, we introduce the weight matrices in this way. And these weight matrices can be used as spectral characteristics for a reconstruction of the differential equation instead of the value co matrix. Theorem 2 is the uniqueness theorem. If we have two problems with the coefficients tau nu and tau nu v tilde, and the eigenvalues of all the problems Lk coincide, and the weight matrices coincide with each other for these two problems, then the coefficients also coincide in the correspondent as elements of the correspondent functional spaces. This is the uniqueness theorem. Next, let us additionally assume that the separation condition holds. So we will write that actually all our problem is described by its coefficients tau nu, and we will write that this problem belongs to the class W simp if the eigenvalues of the corresponding problem problems fulfill the conditions A1 and A2. A1 is the condition of simplicity, and A2 is the separation condition. If the two conditions are satisfied, then it can be shown then the weight matrix has such structure. Only the elements under the main diagonal are non-zero. Can be non-zero. Moreover, if the separation condition holds, then there can there are even more. Actually, there are even more zeros in this matrix because any two neighboring elements of any two neighboring columns cannot be simultaneously non-zero. We have non-zero elements only in the columns for which a fixed lambda Lk is an eigenvalue of the corresponding problem Lk. And that's why we don't need to specify the whole matrix. We can only specify the so-called weight numbers, beta Lk, which are defined as the elements under the main diagonal of this matrix. And if we have two problems satisfying these assumptions, then the eigenvalues and the weight numbers are sufficient for the uniqueness for determining the for the uniqueness of the coefficients tau nu. And next is the main result of my talk is theorem 4, which provides sufficient conditions for the existence of solution. Denote by W plus the class of coefficients tau nu such that these functions are real valued. There are some conditions of self-adjointness. If this condition holds for even order, we have n minus one problems Lk. So we have one problem Lk in the middle. The middle problem, it will be self-adjoint. And the other problems Lk, they will be adjoint to each other. If n equals 2p, Lp minus 1 and Lp plus 1 will be adjoint to each other, etc. And we denote by W plus simp if this condition of self-adjointness satisfied, and additionally, if we have the simple structure of the spectrum, if the assumptions A1 and A2 hold. And the existence theorem is formulated as follows. Let tau nu with tilde be some coefficients satisfying the self-adjointness conditions. And let complex numbers lambda and k and beta k satisfy the assumptions a1, a2, and the following conditions. The condition 15 is the self-adjointness of the spectral data. This condition is that the weight numbers are non-zero. The next condition is different from for even order and odd order. There are some requirements on the problem on the spectral data of the problem LP, which is in the middle. And the next condition is means that these numbers lambda LK and beta LK are asymptotically close to the spectral data of the problem with tilde. The sequence Xi A belongs to L2, where Xi A is defined by this relation. I will explain this condition a little bit later. What does it mean? And the assertion of the theorem, if these conditions hold, then these numbers lambda LK and beta LK are the spectral data of some problem with some coefficients tau nu from this class. And additionally, it can be shown that tau nu belongs to W plus simp, which means that this problem is self-adjoint. Actually, this theorem is formulated as necessary and sufficient conditions, but in fact, these conditions 15 is and 16 are not only sufficient, but also necessary. And the conditions 17 for even order, they also necessary. And for odd order, there is some gap between necessary and sufficient conditions. There is some additional condition for the spectrum of some problem LP. And this is the explanation what does this condition of closedness for the spectral data of the problem with tilde and for lambda LK beta LK, what does it mean? By necessity, we can obtain the following asymptotics, the following sharp asymptotics for the spectral data till this term. Here, kappa LK and eta LK are, form some sequences of L2, and CGK and DGK are some constants which are related to the differential equation coefficients. So for the problem with tilde, we have such asymptotics, and this assumption that Xi A belongs to L2 means that for lambda LK and beta LK, the same asymptotics hold, and the corresponding coefficients are equal to the coefficients with tilde. So this is some asymptotical condition, and if we can find these coefficients CGK and DGK, if we can find some certain relations with the coefficients of the equation, then we can remove this condition 18 and replace it with some condition on asymptotics. But in general, obtaining this asymptotics is very technically complicated. But for some small orders, and it can be done. And next, I will show you examples of corollaries for this theorem in the in the cases of small n. For example, if n equals 2, we obtain the well-known Sturm-Liouville equation with the potential of class W2 minus 1. Here we have only one problem, L1, with the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So for the second order, the separation condition has no meaning. It doesn't exist because we have only one problem. Additionally, we know that its eigenvalues are real and simple, so simplicity also holds by necessity. The weight numbers beta L, they will be, it can be shown that they are inverses to the norms of the eigenfunctions. So they correspond to the spectral data by Marchenko. We obtain the following corollary. The numbers lambda and L and beta L are spectral data of the Sturm-Liouville problem, if and only if the following conditions hold. The first, the structural conditions can be represented in this way. And instead of the condition with this problem, with model problem with tilde, we have such asymptotics. Actually, as the problem with tilde, we can use the problem with zero potential. If this asymptotics are satisfied, then the data will be sufficiently close to the spectral data of the problem with zero potential. This result is not novel. It was obtained for the first time by Grinev and Mikityuk, and it also follows as a corollary from theorem 4. Next example is n equals 3. Then we have this equation. Here, tau 1 is a real valued function, and tau 0 is an imaginary function. Tau 0 belongs to W2 minus 1, and tau 1 belongs to L2. Then we have two problems, L1 and L2. L1 is with one condition at 0, and L2 is with two conditions at 0. For odd order, we have sufficient conditions, which can be formulated as corollary 2. Let some complex numbers satisfy assumptions A1 and A2 of simplicity and separation. Next, the self-adjointness condition take this form. So the spectra are closely related to each other. Actually, we can specify only one spectrum and only one sequence of weight numbers. Then this is the additional condition for an odd order. Beta L1 is non-zero. Automatically, beta L2 is also non-zero. And the asymptotic formulas hold. Here we need more sharp asymptotics with some coefficients theta, which is related to the coefficients of the equation as follows. This is the integral of tau 1. And if we take any data satisfying these conditions, then theorem implies that they are the spectral data of some problem with the coefficients of the corresponding class. This is the result for the third order. This result was this problem for the third order, it was studied in this my paper, and actually in this paper it was studied in a more general case when the separation condition can be violated. Then we have we need some additional data. Roughly speaking, if some some eigenvalues of these two problems coincide, we need some additional weight number for each such pair of eigenvalues. So in this paper, the result is formulated in a more general form. And next is the result for order 4. For order 4, we have this equation, and we have three problems. The problem L2 is self-adjoint, and L1 and L3 are adjoint to each other. And we get the following theorem. For complex numbers to be the spectral data of two with coefficients of this class, it's necessary and sufficient to satisfy the assumptions of simplicity and separation. 15 are the self-adjointness conditions on the spectral data. Here are the structural conditions of the weight, on the weight numbers, and they have to satisfy these asymptotics. You see here we have more terms in the asymptotics, and the terms contain some coefficients, theta, T0, T1, and sigma, which are these coefficients appear in all the asymptotics in different combinations. So you see they appear also in beta, beta L2, beta L1, and L3. The remainder terms are of L2, and this is the relation of these coefficients with the coefficients of the differential equation. Here it can be clear why we consider the case of distributional coefficients, because if we consider more regular coefficients, similar results also can be obtained. But then we need more terms in the asymptotics. We need even more terms, and obtaining these terms is technically complicated, and the relation with the coefficients of differential equation will be more complicated. Here some coefficients are related to tau 2 and sigma is related to tau 1, but if we have more coefficients, then they will be related to the coefficients of the both problems.
Natalia, I'm terribly sorry. Maybe have one more minute.
Okay. Actually, I have nearly finished my talk. Of course, similarly, higher orders can be considered, and higher, more smooth coefficients of differential equation can be considered. But then we need more terms in the asymptotics, and the problem became technically complicated. Anyway, this result, I think this is the first result of this kind, like a complete characterization of the spectral data for order 4, for equation of order 4. My talk is over. Actually, thank you for your attention.
Okay, let's thank our speaker. And does anybody have any questions or comments? Please, we have maybe one minute for quick questions.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Natasha, so every time when you obtain this result, you need to analyze solvability of infinite dimensional system of the form at the beginning of your talk, one minus r, something like this. Every time you need to analyze solvability of this system.
Yes, it's important to note that here there are no requirements of solvability. So the solvability of the system is proved. There was a special method developed for proving its solvability. It relies on the technique of analytic functions. There is some contour integration. Actually here the residue theorem works. Some meromorphic function is constructed, and and some contour integrals are considered, which can be calculated by using the residue theorem. And on the other hand, it can be shown that these integrals tend to zero as radii of the contours tend to infinity. So this is the most difficult part of the proof.
Okay, thank you very much. Very good result, really.
Thank you.
Natasha, can I ask you, for instance, this equation, Could you please show this equation regarding this is fourth order equation regarding theorem 5?
This equation, you mean?
This, yes. So how many coefficients do you have here?
Three coefficients.
Three. Ah, T1 is repeated. Uh-huh. Three coefficients, three spectrum. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So if it in ordinary form, this is equation without generalized coefficients. Yeah. So in fact, you have three potentials, three coefficients.
Yes.
Yes.
But in fact, this data are related to each other because this self-adjointness conditions, you see, we have these conditions. So actually, the spectra of L1 and L3, they are related to each other, and we can specify only one of them. For example, we consider we can consider two spectra of L1 and L2 and two sequences of the weight numbers. So four sequences are sufficient.
But so do you assume self-adjoint to impose self-adjointness condition?
Yes. Yeah.
Not complex case. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. And I'd like to ask one more, maybe in fact several questions. But so please demonstrate theorem 5 with asymptotic behavior. And my question, my question is, what can you reconstruct just from the asymptotic behavior? Usually you can reconstruct boundary conditions immediately, but in your case, it's
in my case, realize. I can construct these coefficients.
These coefficients.
You see, these values of tau 2 and integral tau 1.
But the boundary conditions, usually coefficients from boundary conditions, you can reconstruct from the asymptotic.
Here I have no coefficients. It's the Dirichlet-like
only
case.
Zero. Uh-huh, zero. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, if you replace boundary conditions, even without these trivial coefficients, the asymptotic behavior should change. So this is coefficients should change.
Yes.
Not major. Yeah. And you can reconstruct this.
Yes, I guess that it will be possible to reconstruct the coefficients. But you see, if there are many different cases for higher orders of boundary conditions, and some coefficients cannot be recovered, those coefficients that can be recovered, I think they can be found from the asymptotics.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Or maybe actually I'm not sure because. Maybe only for the highest powers, for the highest derivatives, they can be found. So this question requires a separate investigation.
Uh-huh. Okay, and maybe final question. Yeah. What about the theorem by Greenew and Vigic? Have you extended the result or just repeated?
No, just repeated.
Just repeat it by another method, yeah?
Yeah, I just show that my method corresponds to this result.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And so from this asymptotic, can you, do you see immediately that the coefficient, the potential is from the W minus one class?
Yes.
And where do you see this?
Because if we have regular potential, then we have more terms here. For W2 minus 1, we have kappa L and eta L of L2.
Uh-huh.
Витя, stop it.
Dear colleagues, the more questions you have here, the less time Professor Malamud will get for his own talk. So, I mean, you can repeat to infinity, but...
Yeah, Professor Malamud is very interested in this talk, and maybe...
Yeah, maybe we can.
Может подарить few minutes.
Okay, then it's up to you. It's up to you.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm sorry for so long.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you. I also should speak in English, да? Ну, сейчас, секундочку. Я прошу вас помочь мне. Значит, давайте.